The Tour of Flanders, a fight against appalling cobbles, a battle with gales and driving rain, and the agony of those infamous hills. It's spectacular, dramatic, it's happiness and disappointment, and it's every setback you can imagine. It also brings half of Flanders out onto the streets. But far more than all of that, the Tour of Flanders is an encyclopedia of bike racing's most famous names. Sometimes an outsider can play the stars against each other. The big men were so busy watching one another, the Dutchman Kees Bol has nipped away here. Everyone is watching Eddy Merckx. Nobody will move before he does. Which leaves Bol, who's only 22 years old, to win by 20 seconds. Just as with Yves Dolman, it's the biggest success of his career. There were still 104 kilometers left to go when Eddy Merckx began this attack. With him is Frans Verbeek, and the man in yellow is about to leave our story after a long lone attack that's just failed. The two hardest men in Belgium are flat out across the hills and cobbles. At first the bunch seems unbothered. Then Freddy Mertens and Michel Pollentier think it's time to limit the damage. 65 kilometers from Meyerbecker, the lead's down to a minute and 10 seconds. The roads are flatter now, and the heavily built Verbeek can make a more effective effort.
De Gasket, de Merckx, de Rosé, de Vlaam, de Walter, de Vlot, Frans, Verbeek, Freddy, Martens, Simon, de Macaroni, Spaghetti, de Frutti, Zoete, Melk, Botermelk, Karnemelk, Vlotsmelk, Schopenmelk, Karoprol, de Tabak, Stokkerol, de Molen, Stik, Spelen, Kattekes, met de Rode, Bevrakken, Gera, Patroos, de Geleri.
Daar zijn ze. It's difficult enough to walk up, but Merckx and Verbeek toddle across. They've been together now for 75 kilometers flat out. 10 times Frans Verbeek dies on this climb, but he comes back from the dead each time. Roger de Vlaming at 3.5 minutes behind. Michel Pollentier, Pantens, Martens, Dieriks and De Meyer.
Merckx en Verbeek blijven ongenaakbaar voor.
But the train up front is still in full steam. 5 kilometers to go to the finishing circuit. The lead more than 4 minutes. And then.
En dan gaat Merckx. Verbeek kan er alleen maar naar kijken.
Verbeek could do nothing but watch. Never in his life has he been ridden off a wheel like this. Nobody has dominated the Tour de Flanders quite like Eddy Merckx, repeating again that wonderful win of 1969.
Achter de winnaar een gedubbeld groepje dat nog aan de plaatselijke ronde van 12 kilometer moet beginnen.
Behind Merckx, two groups that have chased up in the final lap all finish in the town. Frans Verbeek, a worthy second and the only man who limited Merckx's destruction. Merckx is on the left, Verbeek in the middle. Watch Verbeek's expression. De Bruin is asking him about the moment Merckx rode him off his wheel. This is the face of a man defeated, the vanquished hero who respects a better man. He was just too fast for me, says Verbeek. What more can I say? They call Francesco Moser the dreamboat of Italian cycling. There was nothing he couldn't do. Marc de Meer was a giant of a man who died at home of a heart attack. And they and Walter Plankert are in the lead here because Roger de Vlaming and Freddy Martins are too busy watching one another in the field. Moser leads, De Meyer is in red. Plankert is watching them both. Moser eases, so does De Meyer, and Plankert freewheels into the lead. Now it's time. Moser, the rouleur. De Meyer, the giant sprinter. Plankert, the buccaneer. De Meyer. Moser goes with Plankert. He leaves De Meyer by himself, and Plankert takes Moser to second place. And then a personal score at the back. De Vlaeminck in blue. Mertens, the fastest finish in the world, is in red. Martins is simply beaten. By the late 1970s, Eddy Merckx was no longer the favourite. His best years were gone. But even so, he was there to dominate the Flanders. He throws the race open in Dierlecke, and then on the old Quaremont, he gets a chance to recall his old popularity. Behind him, half the field packs up and goes home when it gets this far. On the Koppenberg, the old master has a minute's lead. Roger De Vlaeminck gallops off after him, followed by the world champion Freddy Martens, who's riding a bike borrowed from a spectator. Then follows Walter Plankert and Erik De Vlaeminck, who, as 7 times world cyclocross champion, felt a bit more at home on the cobbles. His brother Roger punctures, but nobody's got another bike for him. It's more than a minute before he gets one. Freddy Martens is intussen bij Merckx gekomen. Meanwhile, Freddy Martens gets back up to Merckx. And now watch closely, because that figure in blue is De Vlaeminck. A huge effort to get that minute back.
De grote drie zijn nu samen.
The best of these three is Freddy Martens. Merckx will soon give up, and a year later he'll leave the sport for good.
Nog geen jaar na deze ronde is zijn carrière immers afgelopen.
Martens gets a little help from De Vlaeminck. What's more, Martens has just heard that he's likely to be disqualified for jumping on the spectator's bike, which he borrowed on the Koppenberg. But he ploughs on regardless, riding like a true world champion in one of the best performances of his life. It earns him a lot of sympathy and a great deal of respect.
Ja, dat is mooi voor die mensen die daar staan. De Vlaeminck gaat proberen.
And what's the next policeman? Clearly a De Vlaeminck supporter.
De politieagent is supporter van De Vlaeminck. Officieel mag het niet, maar het is ook een.
Dreesens moves up to talk to Martens about his next move. Dreesens is the man who got Martens to more than 50 wins in a season and back again from disaster afterwards. And De Vlaeminck doesn't look too happy at what he's heard, does he? Get back into the lead, they're shouting at him from the car. And for a moment, De Vlaeminck obliges, even if it's only at half speed. It's the first time for mile after mile that Freddy Martens has been behind him. But the result is inevitable. Martens is exhausted and De Vlaeminck rides ahead effortlessly. Roger De Vlaeminck gets his name into the books as winner of the 1977 Tour of Flanders. Although it's Freddy Martens who gets the sympathy. And it's De Vlaeminck who gets mixed reactions too. Martens is disqualified, and so in third place is Walter Plankert. Sunshine for once for Henny Kuiper, Pollentier and Ludo Peeters.
dat is ingezet door Bernard Hinault, dit jaar voor
and for Bernard Hinault, who set it all going. Hinault is just coming into prominence. He's already won Gent-Wevelgem and Liège-Bastogne-Liège, but today, just before the Koppenberg, he'll say goodbye to this Tour of Flanders. 35 kilometers before Meerbeke, the decision has been taken. Hinault is gone, and so is Kuiper and also Peters. Instead, Pollentier has Walter Godefroot and the German Gregor Braun. Not that Braun got much of a look in. Walter Godefroot is 34 years old, the national champion of Belgium, and now he's won the Tour of Flanders for the second time. Raas, de Vlaming, de Meijer and Walter Plankert, who's about to fall over. The best are in the lead. A group defines itself with Lubberding, Kuiper, Guido van Kalster, Jan Raas, Mark de Meijer, Francesco Moser, Didi Thurau, Schepmans, Plankert, Willems, Godefroot and Zoetemelk. Jan Raas makes a break. De Vlaming en Moser hesitate, but Thurau charges after him and hangs there, 200 meters behind him. Thurau will never catch him. Raas will ride the final 30 kilometers alone. And his win in the Tour of Flanders leads folks to talk of him as the new king of the classics. Mark de Meijer and Francesco Moser attack with Michel Pollentier and Jan Raas on the Koppenberg, the hill that de Vlaming so fond of. His gear has slipped. But it's not just men that are falling, so are the major decisions. Michel Pollentier, Francesco Moser, Freddy Martens, the world champion Jan Raas, and then Roger de Vlaming. Francesco Moser storms the wall at Grammont, but he can't shift Pollentier off his wheel. Nor Raas, Martens, de Vlaming, de Meijer, Duclos Lazelle, Frank Hoster, Gerry Verlinde and Sean Kelly. And now you're watching the decisive moment. At the top of the picture are Pollentier and Moser. Jan Raas senses the danger and sprints off after them. Martens, de Meijer en de Vlaming have left it too late.
Hij pikt aan bij Moser en Pollentier. Het wordt een finale met drie.
Pollentier tries to the left. He's gambling on the rivalry between the two stars, Moser en Raas.
Speculerend op de rivaliteit tussen de twee superstars, Moser en Raas. Het lukt niet. Ook de Italiaan en de Nederlander
he fails. Both the Dutchman
winnen.
And the Italian are also keen to win.
Jan Raas
in theory, Raas is the
snelste,
quicker of the two, but he doesn't get the chance to show it. Pollentier tries yet again, and this time it works. The little man from West Flanders finally gets the reward for all of the work he's put into the race over the years. This year it all happens on the Bosberg with an attack by de Vlaming. But Pollentier is there as well. Then the two young Belgians of the moment, Daniel Willems and Fons de Wolf, with Jan Raas. A new attack from de Vlaming, the freshest man in the closing miles. But Sean Kelly says that's enough, and up he goes.
En dan is Kuiper weg.
The group reforms and then Kuiper gets away. He brings up de Vlaming.
De teerlingen
although
zijn
not enough, and Kuiper at 32 wins, he has his final day of glory.
Gespeeld.
Het is mooi weer. Just a nice, happy, sunny day, except for Freddy Martins.
Freddy Martins, wegens herhaald pech, uit een omvangrijke kopgroep verdwijnt.
Just before the wall, his near namesake, Rennie Martins, tries his luck. He stays ahead on the climb, up to a minute in front. That's quite a ride for Rennie. A sprinter counterattacks Eddie Plankert, but he's too late. Now Rennie Martins wins his first classic in the style of all, in a long, lone break.
Op 20 kilometers
from the finish, the leading group is already defined.
Jan Raas,
the best man in the race, gets away, and Ludo Peters puts the brakes on.
Ludo Peters stopt af. Een automatisme.
Peters just sits there, and nobody moves. Ah, come on, you guys, says Phil Anderson. All right, says Marc Sejean, I'll have a go. But Ludo Peters just tags on too, to guard Jan Raas. These were the days when nobody played a stronger hand than Peter Post's team. It controlled the world. And Raas won Flanders for a second time.
'84
was a dry but cold Tour of Flanders. 40 or 50 riders are away here. A lot to be approaching the Koppenberg at the same time. Phil Anderson is showing the way up. Eddie Plankert is on the left in blue. His teammate Eric van der Aarde is on his wheel. Then Rudy Matthijs with Phil Anderson on the other side in the white.
De blauwe muts, dat is Eddie Plankert en Eric van der Aarde erachteraan. Hier komt Rudy Matthijs aan in zijn spoor, dan Phil Anderson aan de andere kant van de weg. Dus Eddie Plankert aan de leiding, Rudy Matthijs, dan Van der Aarden. Phil Anderson die gaat daar in het publiek, Roger de Vlaming te voet.
And when even Roger de Vlaming gets off his bike, you know the lesser lights will struggle even more. And down they all go.
Petito staat daar te voet. Dat is wellicht ook Rudy Danens die we daar rechts zien krabbelen. Nog meer renners te voet.
A great mess of bodies and bikes, and this is the leading group, remember. When Bernard Hinault said he was never going to ride the Tour of Flanders again, that it was all a stupid gamble and a stunt, well, this is just what he had in mind. And still they go down with 250 meters to go to the top.
De beste komen vaak naar voor op die Koppenberg, in het verleden ook vaak daar Francesco Moser vooraan, nu afwezig. En hier dus...
It was one long cyclo-cross race, with another 100 or more riders still to come. The smooth flat roads that follow, though, are paradise. We're up with the leaders again on the way to the wall of Grammont. Number 60 is Van den Brandt. And number 55, Rudy Matthijs.
Met het nummer 24.
This is Johan Lammerts.
Johan Lammerts. En dan komen wij de renners die daar straks voor aanreden.
Number 128 is Ferdy Vandenhout.
Ook Ludo de Keulenaar.
This is de Koolenaar.
22. Dan krijgen we daar
Jean-Luc Vandenbroek.
En aan de leiding misschien wel
and
de
the favorite of the group, Sean Kelly.
Voor vandaag Sean Kelly.
A pause and Johan Lammerts
Johan
goes.
Lammerts nog weer. Helemaal links. En nu moeten ze uitkijken.
And now they have to watch
wacht
out.
Kelly even en springt hij dan in zijn eentje naartoe. Maar heeft Lammerts genoeg in huis?
Ludo de Koolenaar senses a chase. He moves in to protect Lammerts. And the rest go too.
De Koolenaar moet al reageren, want er zijn renners die een tegenactie hebben opgezet. Koolenaar nu in dienst van zijn ploegmaat Johan Lammerts. Het zal natuurlijk een sterk staaltje zijn als Peter Post hier... met een van zijn renners uit de tweede rij, met een van de helpers uit de ploeg, toch de overwinning zou kunnen binnenhalen.
And yet another happy day for Peter Post, this time Johan Lammerts. He really is just a domestique for his team, but in with a chance of victory nevertheless. And he does it too, just a young Dutchman, 23 years old. And he's not the only one who's pretty happy about it either.
Een goede middag, dames en heren, vanuit de.
It's every bit as miserable as it looks. The rain's been falling since the start. The clouds a little higher than the trees, and the riders are cold, wet, and miserable. Of the 173 who set off, you're looking at everyone who's left after 200 kilometers. Just 30, maybe 35 riders. And the worst is still to come. We're on the approach here to the Koppenberg, 70 kilometers from the end. Four out of every five who started the race have already packed because of the rain and cobbles. Now those that are left face the succession of freak hills that pack themselves into the closing miles of every Tour of Flanders. Peter Post's men are there again at the front. Phil Anderson leads, Eddie Plankert is at his side. And as if the cobbles weren't enough, the spectators can sometimes make them even worse. Nico Verhoeven, that is from Holland. Eddie Plankert follows him up. Kelly is there. Greg LeMond is also behind him, as is Phil Anderson. But the one man leading up the Koppenberg is Nico Verhoeven.
LeMond die daar in de berm terechtkomt, Van der Poel hier, Kelly die daar ook stilvalt.
Kelly, Jeff Leekens gets his foot to the ground just in time. And down they all come behind him. LeMond gets by. Marc Sergent. And a spectator gets hold to leave well alone, if you please. Henny Kuiper gets off his bike too. And the spectator hasn't learned his lesson, has he? Jean-Marie Vompers, he's in there too. Paul Hagedoren, Etienne de Beul, Luc Colline and Eric van der Aarden. That's van der Aarden there in the Belgian's champion jersey. And still on his bike too, which is quite something. Sticking to the gutter and trying to avoid the cobbles.
Maar alle anderen te voet naar boven klauteren. Uiterst rechts in de goot. Hij probeert de stenen te mijden en blijft rijden.
En still at the front, it's Nico.
Hier dan de eenzame koploper, dat is Nico Verhoeven, een Nederlander.
And he's followed by Phil Anderson and Eddie Plankert.
Phil Anderson and Eddie.
With Adrie van der Poel behind them both.
En dan met een grijns ook Adrie van der Poel.
Meanwhile, they're still in misery at the back.
Dit zijn de achterblijvers. En dat zijn de drie koplopers.
But they're happy enough at the front, Verhoeven, Anderson, Plankert.
Van der Poel maakt nog altijd jacht in zijn eentje. Verderop, met een grotere achterstand al.
And as you can see, what's left of the race has been blown wide open. LeMond is down there, so too is Kelly.
En de rest van de groep heeft meer.
And all of the others shattered on the climb. And that's the rest of the group with van der Aarden in there with them. Adrie van der Poel is the other chaser. Sean Kelly, Greg LeMond.
Opspattend slijk hier onder de wielen van de motoren.
Thick, slippery mud and water.
De hele dag heeft het al geregend.
It's rained the whole day in this most awful edition of the Tour of Flanders. And this is what happens.
Een renner van de ploeg. Torhout Werchter. Dat is de herhaling. Komt er in de vrije natuur terecht. En de hergroepering komt er.
And we're now looking at the lead group. There are six riders here.
Zes koplopers.
The riders are Phil Anderson, Eddie Plankert, Nico Verhoeven, and they've been caught by Adrie van der Poel, Sean Kelly and Greg LeMond. And there's the rest of the race, all that's left out of 173. The race is now half a minute down on the leaders, with Eric van der Aarden doing most of the work to close the gap. And this is Henny Kuiper on his wheel. And Rogier and Jeff Leekens. And also Ludo de Keulenaar.
Leekens en de Keulenaar zijn er eveneens bijgekomen. Weer sterk ook Ludo de Keulenaar. Hij heeft een geweldig seizoen. De ideale knecht. En Jeff Leekens, een kandidaat ook op de overwinning. Van der Aarde gaat door met Kuiper. Ze komen bij de kop.
And now we're back with the leaders here.
Voorbij de Eikenberg. Erik van der Aarden is terug.
Erik van der Aarden in de Belgian champions jersey. And it is Henny Kuiper who attacks. Just imagine the fitness you need to do that at this stage of a terrible edition of the race. And Phil Anderson and Van der Poel just wait.
Blijven hangen, worden gegrepen.
So it's left to Erik van der Aarden to take up the chase.
Kelly blijft zitten, Anderson kijkt uiteraard om.
Sean Kelly sticks where he is, Anderson keeps a lookout. Leekens has just made a big effort, so van der Aarden stays away.
Verhoeven reageert nu toch en Phil Anderson countert hem al meteen. En meteen heeft hij een kloof geslagen. Rudy Rogiers nu recht op de trappers.
Rudy Rogiers goes, but Anderson goes with him. The helicopter shot shows you from the top. Kuiper, then 25 seconds down the road, is van der Aarden.
Phil Anderson nog verder op het groepje. Misschien gaat Erik van der Aarden wel even wachten op Phil Anderson.
Schitterende ronde van Vlaanderen vol peripecieën.
Leekens helps the chasers get closer. And Anderson sprints away from Rogiers. He took his moment perfectly and he's going to try to get across now to Erik van der Aarden, the leader of his team.
Te malen tot bij zijn kopman van der Aarde. Indrukwekkende Phil Anderson.
Jan and van der Aarden understands. He eases back for Phil Anderson. Now we have two teammates in the lead together and only Henny Kuiper out in front of them.
Drink niet te fel meer aan, nee.
There's Kuiper and the yellow car goes by because the chasers are now so close and Kuiper knows it.
Ze komen dus samen. Van der Aarde trekt.
With the rain easing slightly, Erik van der Aarden reduces the wear. He looks for his team car to pass in the raincoat.
Maar ze blijven goed samen. Kuiper die het tempo aanzet.
So onto the wall of Gramont, the three are together.
Die hem doodgemoedereerd volgen. En daar is Erik van der
Aarden. And there's van der Aarden, the Belgian champion, with just a little lead on Phil Anderson. And Kuiper, tired now and just behind.
9 seconden konden we daarnet aflezen van het scherm. En hij gaat door. Hij is nog niet boven. Straks moeten ze nog een haakse bocht naar rechts nemen.
Van der Aarden is now clear on the wet stones. Kuiper has passed Anderson and they're chased by the photographers. Over the top, it is Erik van der Aarden.
Aerodynamische positie hier in de afdaling.
And a very nice position indeed for the way down, the minimum resistance to the wind. It's impressive this day. Erik van der Aarden, 7 races he's won already this year, but this is going to be the sweetest of them all. And this is the voice of the television commentator telling us van der Aarden's increased his lead to 45 seconds with 6 kilometers or so to go. This is Peter Post with his head out of the window. And the rain is coming down in torrents once more. The last straight road of the race, 700 meters long, and van der Aarden's in there somewhere among all of the lights. It's the first classic he's won, the first all-category race, and surely even he couldn't have dreamed that he'd do it like this. For Erik van der Aarden, even for his standards, this was a superb performance. A wave to the crowd, and he even had time to look around. Erik van der Aarden wins the Tour de Flanders in front of enormous crowds who surely can't regret the hours now they've spent standing in the rain waiting for a Belgian to arrive.
The
In the modern Tour of Flanders, the gateway to the hills is the old Quaremont. And because every bike fan in Belgium knows that, they line the road in huge numbers. Little Broys grow up with pictures like this in their mind, which means that Eddy Plankert feels perfectly at home here. But on the Petersberg that follows, it's Erik van der Aarden again. Le Mans in third position after Jos Lammertink. Steve Bauer and Francesco Moser. Jean-Philippe van den Brandt. Noel Segers with his foot on the ground. Claude Coquillon, Laurent Fignon. Paul Hagedorn, the Belgian champion. Henk Lubeding, Urs Froiler. Ludo Peters.
Van der Aarden is niet tot het uiterste gegaan, maar heeft dus nu wel het voordeel dat hij tenminste ongestoord.
And at the front of the group, Erik van der Aarden again.
Nu is het elk voor zich.
On the right of our picture, Marc Sergent tries the other route. Plankert behind van der Aarden, then comes Sean Kelly. Greg LeMond, once again, is also here.
Hoogteverschil hier 65 meter. Begin niet zo stijl. Lammertink dan ook.
Jos Lammertink is alongside Kelly. And that's a Persia rider that's gone down. Ferdy Vandenhout manages to get by him and he's still on his bike. But look at what's happened at the back. You've only got to have someone lose his balance for a moment and this happens.
Een renner die eventjes uit het evenwicht gaat en het is gebeurd. En door het feit dat we die wapenstilstand hebben.
It's not just everyone off their bikes. It's more or less a traffic jam as well. I don't suppose these guys are very grateful. But for those who lost contact on the Paterberg, well, it's good news. Because we're just seeing them all come back. Out of all of that, Sean Kelly is the man who is up the front now with Erik van der Aarden. Not sure the supporters, these two riders, the top Belgian and the top Irishman who lives in Belgium, Kelly, who's never won the Tour of Flanders and it's always been his target. Puncture for Eddy Plankert. And Peter Post is not around, so Eddy has got to rely on the service coming from a neutral car. The change is a slow one.
Plankert blijft er kalmer bij dan Greg LeMond vorig jaar. Dit heeft hem toch ook ruim een halve minuut gekost. En hij is nog niet weg, kijk eens.
And there's still trouble. So Eddy Plankert is now losing big time.
Bijna even erg als vorig jaar met Greg LeMond. Hoe is dat mogelijk?
In a manner similar to Greg LeMond last year. He's lost now more than 3/4 of a minute.
Eddy Plankert heeft na die bandbreuk zijn
plaats. But astonishingly, he gets back to the leaders. And as if that wasn't enough, 30 kilometers from the finish, he attacks as well. Steve Bauer's gone with him. But on the wall, Plankert's paying the price. You can see the gap is now there.
Slag van door. En Plankert veel moeizamer. Die zien we inderdaad duidelijk het verschil. En we begrijpen nu al beter.
Steve Bauer, the Canadian rider, is clearly the stronger.
Steve Bauer, duidelijk de sterkste van de twee. Eddy, wat
Eddy Plankert is giving it all he can, but it's simply not enough.
Snelling nog altijd klauterend op die muur. Dat wordt nog zwaar hier naar het einde toe. En kijk, daar is Kelly nu al.
Sean Kelly in the lead here has now been joined by the red jersey Claude Coquillon. Then follows Van den Brandt. The time gap showing in the picture.
Segers ook hier links in beeld, Erik van der Aarden dan.
Bauer's moment disappears in the closing phases. Sean Kelly can see his first Tour of Flanders now coming towards him. Van den Brandt follows him, then follows Adrie van der Poel. You can only imagine what's going through Sean Kelly's mind now. He's a great sprinter.
Dat zijn vermoedelijk de twee die het zullen uitvechten voor de overwinning.
Sean Kelly is in the lead, He's watching Adrie van der Poel. Kelly's had a real hard ride today, but he's going to wind it up from the front. He's made the mistake of going too soon. No one's going to help him. Bauer fighting back. Van der Poel, Van der Brand. Bauer tries. Kelly, Van der Poel takes it on the line. Now, here it is again. Sean Kelly is leading.
Kelly dus lange tijd op kop in die sprint.
Then Adrie van der Poel begins to move up. And Sean Kelly can't hold him off. Van der Poel goes straight by him. What a mistake by Sean. First Van der Poel, second Kelly, third Van der Brand and fourth Steve Bauer. In this year, there are 16 kilometers left. And the best 10 stick together. Claude Criquillion.
Blijven nog altijd samen. En nu toch een demarrage.
As Claude Criquillion attacks, it is Sean Kelly who reacts.
Claude Criquillion, maar Kelly gaat.
Then goes Marc Sejean, the new champion of Belgium. Stephen Rux also.
En ook Steven Rux reageert. Criquillion weg. Sejean erachteraan. Piper als vaak ontmeet.
This is Steven Rux at the back.
Dit is dan Steven Rux. Maar Criquillion nog niet bijgehaald. Van der Aarde gaat.
Eric van der Aarde goes. Sean Kelly though is right on his wheel.
Niet vertrekken. En ook Ludo Peters probeert aan te sluiten. Gaat Kelly
but no luck this time. Kelly does go through. Van der Aarde drops back.
Niet meer aan. Kelly dan.
1 minuut en 5 seconden voorsprong.
But don't let's forget Criquillion. A minute and 5 seconds he now has in the lead. And there he is, one of the few French-speaking Belgian riders in top-class competition. Jean-Luc Vandenbroek's another one. Despite his name. And Ferdy Bracker, the old hour record holder, was another. But there haven't been very many. Claude Criquillion, who got involved in a legal battle with Steve Bauer after a crash at the finish of the World Road Race Championship in his own country in Belgium. The final 600 meters now, and Claude Criquillion, another lone winner in the 71st Tour of Flanders. These are the 11 leaders, Rux, Van der Poel, Tournisser and Darnens. Their four teammates and then the seven solo riders, Kelly, De Wilde, Plankert Anderson, Motta, Calcaterra and Marc Sergeant, who at this moment attacks with 35 kilometers to go. Rudy Darnens is the man who goes with him and Phil Anderson in a big gear. In the group, Sean Kelly has a good look around. Anything happening from anywhere? And the answer is not very much. So Sean Kelly goes off by himself. Anderson is not yet up with the leaders. And it's Plankert who goes after Kelly, so does Adrie van der Poel. This is Phil Anderson with Darnens and Marc Sejean. Sean Kelly arrives. And they're all back together.
En wij naderen nu stilaan Geraardsbergen. Ze zijn weer met z'n elfen samen.
Then is the turn of the ever-aggressive Dutchman Adrie van der Poel, who's now the Dutch champion. He breaks the calm. But there is still no interest from the rest. There are too many teammates to stop the chase anyway, which leaves van der Poel alone in the front.
Hij is wel snel, maar er zitten hier nog de duchte sprinters. Onder meer.
It's fast enough in the chase. The sprinters are all here. Eddie Plankert, Tournisser with Rux on his wheel, and then a counterattack from Phil Anderson. Only for him to be pounced on by the PDM riders.
Van de ploeg PDM. Voorop dus. Adrie van der Poel. De reactie is er van Phil Anderson. Marc Sergeant aarzelt.
Then in the top left of our screen, there are three riders clear.
En ze zijn met z'n tweeën weg. En het stipje daarachter, dat is misschien Eddie Plankert.
And the motorbike shows us that Eddie Plankert, Phil Anderson, Adrie van der Poel.
En nu ook Eddie Plankert.
We're now approaching the Bosberg. And now you can see that Anderson and Plankert have broken clear of the others.
Afgehaakt, ging er rechts in uw beeld. Hij moest dus verrassend toch wel.
With 13 kilometers to go, you can see now on the Bosberg they have a clear lead.
Van der Poel ingelopen, maar voorop hier nog altijd Plankert en Phil Anderson met een grote versnelling op weg nu naar Meerbeke.
Anderson in the bigger gear, Plankert still at the front, getting closer to Meerbeke all of the time. Eddie Plankert, a sprinter on the attack, with his former teammate. Plankert's team manager comes up for a word and Anderson uses the distraction to launch an attack. I don't know what the conversation was about and I don't suppose Plankert does either, since he didn't get much of a moment to develop, did it? And the helicopter now gives you an idea of the gap. There's plenty of time for a tactical sprint. Anderson has the lead. Hardly moving, but you can feel the tension. Phil Anderson has never won this race and he's going to make Plankert pay dearly to beat him. Eddie Plankert, the faster of the two, sitting there waiting. It's the perfect position for a sprinter as fast as Eddie Plankert racing on home soil. The Australian Phil Anderson must have known at this point he couldn't really outride Eddie Plankert. And with a home crowd to cheer him on, Plankert made it look easy, winning by a length. If Eddie Plankert rides the way he did in Harelbeke on Saturday, he's my favourite today. I think Adrie van der Poel. Van der Aarde, Plankert, De Wilde. I wouldn't want to put them in any order though. The verdict of the former stars, but there's never a shortage of views either among the thousands who line the start. The weather, clear and dry, although it would change later. Indeed, the rain and the Tour of Flanders, the bad weather, had followed the race yet again. The corner that approaches now is like ice. That's Frans Maassen who's fallen. He's hurt and the bike is also damaged. The steering appears to have gone wrong. Frans Maassen, though, is not alone in his misery. Now we see Etienne de Wilde in the ditch with Guido Bontempi. They've missed the corner in the rain.
And it is Bontempi zelf, wellicht, die meer tijd verliest.
The Norwegian rider Dag Otto Lauritsen is the first man to reach the wall of Grammont. In the group behind him are Marc Sergent, Edwig van Hooydonk and Herman Frieson of Belgium. The Dutchman Hermans, the Dane Sorensen and the Australian Alan Piper. The weather makes the wall no easier. Van Hooydonk picks his way carefully. Sergent is behind him and then comes Lauritsen. There are 17 kilometers to go. Sergent, Sorensen.
Hermans daar rechts, Frieson.
We also have Hermans and Frieson. Such despair for Marc Sergent as he calls up the service car, but there isn't one there. And still, there's no help for Marc Sergent.
En dan zijn we bij de twee koplopers.
There are now two leaders, Edwig van Hooydonk nearest the camera and Dag Otto Lauritsen. Well, there's Sergent's service on the move. Meanwhile, just before the Bosberg, Mathieu Hermans has got up to the leaders. And Sorensen's there as well, so too is Piper. We're now at the foot of the Bosberg and the whole group is back together.
And that is then the 12th and last hill.
Now don't confuse the number 12 with the caption, because this means it is hill number 12, the last of the day, and it's 13 kilometers to go. Now this is what you call power. Edwig van Hooydonk has gone clear, brimming with freshness after all of the day's rain and hills.
frisheid, kracht.
En Van Hooydonk is weg.
Edwig is now 20, then 30 meters. Lauritsen is fighting on the climb himself. But Van Hooydonk is proving unstoppable.
En Lauritsen heeft het moeilijk daar met die kleine versnelling tegen een ontketende Edwig van
Hermans, Lauritsen, Frison, Piper are all having troubles on the cobblestones.
Hermans en Sørensen en Piper en Frison en Sergeant, die hebben het moeilijk op die kasseistoen.
50 meters now is what Van Hooydonk's lead is, and he looks back over his shoulder.
En dan Lauritsen die ook omkijkt nu, en dan de andere op sleeptouw genomen nu door Mark Sergeant op de laatste helling van de dag, de Bosberg.
Just look at the smooth power as Edwig van Hooydonk turns this big gear over. His lead has gone up to 18 seconds with about 10 kilometers still to ride. It all depends now on who's the freshest at the finish, and that, without a doubt, is Edwig van Hooydonk.
En dat lijkt me toch wel deze Edwig van Hooydonk te zijn.
En reactie nu van sergeant
the chase group, and there is a reaction.
Iedereen probeert er om beurt. Eerst was het Sørensen, nu sergeant.
Mark Sergeant and Rolf Sørensen retaliate. 20, 30 meters, and then Alan Piper goes as well.
Zolang het man tegen man gaat, behoudt Van Hooydonk alle kansen, dacht ik. Gevaarlijker zou het zijn als ze echt mooi beginnen af te lossen hier en samen te werken.
But then it all comes back together again, with Van Hooydonk still powering away alone in the front, as the rest now just think about second place. 22 years old, this was to be Edwig Van Hooydonk's first big classic victory. It's a big day for Belgian cycling, a triumph. Van Hooydonk, his first classic win, but certainly it would not be his last.
Eerste klassieke zege, maar zeker niet de laatste.
En ook niet de meeste, hè, Mark. Voor ons de schoonste hier, hè, die we kunnen presenteren, hè, vanuit het buitenland uit. Hè.
Zoals hij het in de jeugdcategorieën deed. Iedereen op afstand rijden. Alleen winnen, kan het zelf niet geloven.
It's quite remarkable that someone so young can just ride the race off the wheel and do it without help. Van Hooydonk, the winner of the Tour of Flanders. And in the race for second place, it was Mark Sergeant. Sørensen, the others are there as well. But as they come to the line, it's Frison, Lauritsen, Sørensen, Hermans. And even when it's your happiest day, you can be allowed to cry.
In de armen van zijn verzorger.
Oh, ik snap het zelf ook niet wat ik het allemaal kan. Ik kan het zelf niet geloven.
And he says, I just can't believe it myself.
Van
Hooydonk's voice says, I'm so pleased, but I'd just like the public and the press to calm down a bit, because I'm still in a daze.
Goedemorgen, dames en heren.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We're ready for the 74th Tour of Flanders.
De 74ste ronde van Vlaanderen. Bent u nu ook wielerliefhebber geworden?
And he asks this chap, are you a bike racing fan? And he says, well, yes, I've been following bike racing since I was a kid. I was a supporter of Rick Van Looy, and we've asked the computer who's going to win today, and it says, first Eddie Plankert, second Argentin, third Musier. One of those three will indeed win the Tour de Flanders of 1989, but did the computer really know something, or was it luck? For once, it's a sunny Sunday, and that brings the crowds out along the road. It also encourages the traditional early breakaway. The Italian, Fabio Roscioli, with company at first and then holding out alone. But then all good things come to an end. Roscioli now has just 5 meters lead on Michel Dernis and Rudy Darmans, and this group of four or five. The commissaire is motorbike. This is Herman. And then a gap of 20 metres or so before Mario van Driest marks as Jean-Carlo Bowman's Laurent Fignon, Jan Wijnands. Frans Maassen is in here as well, along with Eddie Plankett and Moreno Argentin. Jeff Leekens, Van Hooijdonk en Van der Aarden are all here. And the most important riders are in this big bunch. We're looking now at a lead group of eight. Rudy Darlans at the back.
Dan hebben we Roscioli, de vroege vluchter, Michel Dernies.
Roscioli is in front of him. Michel Dernies is here in the black and green.
Dan komen we hier bij onze Panasonic-kameraad Alan Piper.
Alan Piper is in the red colours of Panasonic. Moreno Argentin, who's got up to this group, and the Italian Calcaterra are all here. Alan Piper, who lives near the finishing line, is again in a decisive move.
Laurent Fignon,
they say, is chasing up. He's already collected Dernies, who punctures. Working together, the two of them now come back to the leaders. Argentine is away with Piper behind him. Fignon, Calcaterra, Pedersen. And Dernies. And we can't see it yet, but word's coming in that Laurent Fignon has caught Argentin and Piper out front and he's gone straight by.
Nu zijn ze echt mekander aan het vermoorden hier van voren.
En ik geloof dat Fignon doorgegaan is. Uitkijken jongens, ik denk dat Fignon doorgegaan is vooraan op volle kracht. Kijk maar. Verschil is klein, maar opletten, Fignon die... beseft misschien ook dat dat groepje daarachter niet mag terugkomen.
So while this select little group settles down to the chase, the leaders in fact have also regrouped.
Pedersen en Dernies gaat nu.
On the far side of the road, Michel Dernies goes again.
Ook een goed momentje om die tweede groep terug te komen.
Calcaterra, Piper, but no real chase from behind. Then Laurent Fignon goes, and he's got Per Pedersen with him.
Per Pedersen aan zijn wiel. Hier hebben we Laurent Fignon met Per Pedersen. Ja, Fignon wil die groep nog verder uitdunnen.
Ongelooflijk hoe die rijdt. Ja, hij blijft gewoon rijden, maar ik vrees toch dat in die finale hij moet toch een beetje voorzichtig zijn.
Everyone is impressed by the way Laurent Fignon has kept on attacking, but they wonder how wise he is. The Tour de Flanders is a tough race. Moreno Argentin reaches them and Fignon looks to the left, only to have Argentin go clear. He's ridden straight by. Easy to underestimate the Tour de Flanders. The experts are now saying these early attacks could prove costly later. Moreno Argentin with Rudy Darlans nicely placed after reacting well, getting up to him without bringing the rest. It seems Laurent Fignon is not bothered now about trying again. That's Michel Dernies chasing at the front, but he doesn't seem to be making much progress either.
Dat wil zeggen dat een Argentijn het echt meent dat hij vol doorgaat. Hij heeft ook een heel goede man mee, Rudy Danes, die ook zijn werk wel zal doen.
We gaan zo te zien een hergroepering krijgen.
Dat zou ik nog niet zo direct durven zeggen, Mark, omdat er toch een oneenigheid is achter. Ja.
The Italian champion, Moreno Argentin, has earned a reputation as king of the early classics. But the question was now, had he gone too early? There was still the wall and the Bosberg to come.
Die wil inderdaad deze vlucht tot een goed eind te brengen. Ja, kijkt eens naar Danes, die naar zijn gevoelen niet voldoende steun verleent.
Danes gelooft er niet echt in die ontsnapping.
Die wil nog een beetje reserve houden.
Ja. En Danes kent natuurlijk heel goed die finale en die weet wat er allemaal nog gaat komen. Dus die denkt wanneer ik hier voor alles geef en ze komen er terug bij, dan kan ik misschien krachten tekort komen op die muur of die Bosberg. Dus die houdt nog reserves, dat kun je zien.
The Belgian Rudy Darlans was living through his best time as a professional, while Laurent Fignon, number 11 here, seemed to have lost his thirst for the action.
Nu moet je gokken, hè?
Nu moet je gokken. Nu moet hem de leiding opbrengen. Zeker. Nu moet hij het wiel gaan zitten.
Nee, hij doet het niet.
Dat is spijtig.
Ja, ik vrees ook dat...
Dat vind ik... Dan... Nee.
And so, they lined up for the sprint finish.
Dat kan niet.
Up on the pedals, rehearsing for the sprint. Another little shuffle as Argentin prepares to sprint once again.
Die is aan het klaarmaken voor de sprint. Die is al
Die zet zich klaar.
Ja. En
Rudy. En Rudy, ja. Dat is verloren.
Argentin has got the advantage as they approach the finish. Sitting in the slipstream of Rudy Darnans. Darnans, like Plankert previously, has the advantage of a home crowd. But he hasn't got the finish of the great Italian. Argentin waited for as long as he possibly could. And when he could see the banner clearly, he went for the line.
Probeert nog wel naar dat wiel te
komen. De 74th Tour de Flanders was his.
Argentin wint de 74ste ronde van Vlaanderen. Voor Rudy Darnans is tweede. En wie krijgen we dan even?
Rudy Darnans finished in second and he was very disappointed.
Carlo Bomans als vierde op 6 seconden.
The Tour de Flanders in 1991 had 200 riders, well, 199 to be absolutely precise. The weather forecast for April the 7th, rain drying up a bit later, but strong headwinds. We have a lead group here of 24 riders.
De Ronde van Vlaanderen voorlopig waar we nog geen vat op hebben. Waar je wel kan zeggen een Ballerini lijkt de sterkste man te zijn, maar waar je op dit moment nog geen vat op hebt om te zeggen wie er gaat winnen.
The aging Italian professional Guido Bontempi finds it all a little bit quiet, so he tests the leaders. For a while there is no reaction, and then follows the Wolf of Belgium and Jesper Skibbe of Denmark, and then Rolf Sorensen, another Dane. Then goes Johan Museeuw, who's riding well. Marc Madio. De Wolf's having troubles now, you can see that, he's got Museeuw right on his wheel here.
Museeuw aan het wiel. Ja, je zegt het, een lastig stuk, is inderdaad een zeer lastig stuk.
Well, could it be a bluff to get Museeuw to close the gap?
Dubbel plooien, er alles uitpersen.
Die moet echt het onderste uit de kan.
Well, Museeuw doesn't, so it's left to the Wolf to do it himself.
Maar die heeft er strak volgens mij toch veel van zijn krachten.
This is now the road to Brakel, and you can see the way the groups are beginning to develop.
We zijn op weg naar Brakel en via onze helikoptercamera zien we hoe alles vooraan weer samenkomt.
Opgelet, we zijn op de.
Now into the town of Brakel itself, and this is a 1-in-8 climb. Philippe Bouvatier is the first rider through, followed by Rolf Goltz. A nice reaction from Edric van Hooijdonk, with Rolf Sorensen following him.
De twee Ariosteas mee en die slaan meteen een kloof.
The leaders group up. Edric van Hooijdonk again attacks. Sorensen hangs on. Sorensen's teammate Rolf Goltz joins them, or at least tries to. Just look at the length of the seat pin on the bike of Edric van Hooijdonk. His long but thin legs.
Museeuw rijdt ook goed. Kijk, die komt helemaal alleen terug aansluiten.
Sorensen's in the saddle now, and they're all together at the front.
Die vier. Tussen die vier gaat het nu.
Down the streets of Brakel. It looks like these four are going to win, or at least share the victory, by the time they get to Meerbeke. It's van Hooijdonk who continues to force the pace.
Goltz gaat nog mee, maar
schakelen dan ook.
Dat is echt heel.
On the steepest part of the climb now, you can almost feel the pain in van Hooijdonk's legs. Sorensen, Museeuw, they've got to get back on the wheels in front. It looks as though they're still strong enough to do it.
En inderdaad, dus
and they do, all four regroup over the top of the climb. On towards the Bosberg, Sorensen, van Hooijdonk, Goltz and Museeuw, 500 meters of cobblestones. Goltz loses his place to Museeuw as he reaches down to change a gear.
En Goltz probeert nu terug, ja, kijk. Komt nu terug aan het wiel van Hooijdonk, die gaat aanvallen. Aanval van Hooijdonk.
An attack at the front, Edric van Hooijdonk has gone again. They call him the boss of the Bosberg. He's waited for this climb and he's gone.
Van Hooijdonk is weg, want hij heeft verschrikkelijk erop getraind.
Sorensen and Museeuw try to counter the move of Edric van Hooijdonk. Those spindly legs producing so much power yet again on the Bosberg.
Dat is niet te weinig. Dat is formidabel, dat is.
To the cheers of the frenzied Belgian spectators, Edric van Hooijdonk is again stamping his authority on this race. Behind was Rolf Sorensen and Johan Museeuw. With less than 11 kilometers to go now, van Hooijdonk was heading for victory once more. There was nobody in his sights. And so, approaching the finish, this time there were no tears on the face of Edwig van Hooydonk, just moments of elation as he applauds the crowd in the home straight in Meerbeke.
Die voor de tweede keer in 3 jaar de Ronde van Vlaanderen wint, dames en heren, op een schitterende manier. Hij was de beste en dat wist iedereen in die finale. En als je het dan kan afmaken ook, dan is het prachtig natuurlijk.
And behind the sprint for second place being led out by Rolf Goltz. Johan Museo, the feared Belgian sprinter, is in the middle. He waits for his moment. Rolf Sørensen tries to go with him as Goltz drops away. His job done for his teammate. But his teammate couldn't do his job. Johan Museo finishes second.
Dan Sørensen, dan Goltz als vierde. Maar een schitterende wedstrijd ook van Johan Museo.
The old Quaremont is traditionally the first real hill in any Tour of Flanders these days. This group's been away since about 40 kilometers. The biggest lead has been 22 minutes. On the old Quaremont, 110 kilometers from the finish, they still have 16 minutes.
Hervé Mijvis en Patrick Roeland hier in beeld.
This is Patrick Roeland running into difficulty for the first time. It won't be long now before he gives up for good. So too will one of these. And that leaves just two riders, the Frenchman Jackie Durand and the Swiss Thomas Wegmüller. The whole field now, led by the Ariostia riders, is in angry mood. The early breaks have long been a feature of the Tour of Flanders, but normally they're by unknown riders and they never succeed. The stars know that small breaks have no chance.
Vooral gezien de weersomstandigheden. Het is wel windstil en zonnig. Het is minder hard dan toch.
This is Phil Anderson, who could do with advice. Luckily, with a microphone on his handlebars and a plug in his ear, he can call up his team manager Jim Okovitz whenever he likes. But this time, he's left it too late. On the Petersburg, Adrie van der Poel goes to the head of the favourites, the Van Hooydonk group. Now the chase is on. The two nobodies are still away in the lead and the distance to Meerbeke is coming down all of the while. The motorbike at the head of the race carries a blackboard with the numbers of the two leaders on it. More importantly, the extent of the lead. The long line gives you the impression that for the first time, they're taking that lead seriously. The pace goes up on every climb. This is Frans Maassen on the climb of the Bosberg along with Van Hooydonk, Museeuw and Van der Poel. The news they are getting isn't good. The harder they go, the less they can bring back the leaders. On the wall of Gramont or Gerardsbergen, Wegmüller and Durand are 2.5 minutes still to the good. Van Hooydonk, Fondriest. Fondriest takes them over the top.
Fondriest.
Ja, Fondriest kan er
een kloof gevallen. Danes.
Danes.
Moreels.
The leaders are now well on the way to Meerbeke. Two unknowns will soon take the major shares of this year's Tour of Flanders.
Ze gaan zich moeten reppen, zeg ik.
Ja.
En inderdaad, de reactie
van Driest en Van Hooydonk have simply left it all too late. In 1992, the Bosberg was no longer the place where Van Hooydonk could secure his third Tour of Flanders win. Instead, on the Bosberg, Jackie Durand has ridden Thomas Wegmüller off his wheel. The 25-year-old Frenchman is about to make the Tour of Flanders his first big win of his career. Absolutely unbelievable. He's crying, his eyes out, but you know the Frenchman would go on to have an excellent career. After the events of the previous year, the organisers have worked out a new route to the old Quaremont. The riders now have to go over a record 16 hills. Here we're looking down on the lead group again, which includes all of the pre-race favourites. Edwig van Hooydonk attacks, that man again. And coming up is Johan Museeuw. Mark Sejon is leading the chase here, followed by Frans Maassen, the Dutchman, and then Ludwig Willems.
Van Hooijdonk.
Van Hooijdonk dus, Museeuw, Sergeant Maassen. En wie komt er dan nog? Hier.
Ja, wel, nee.
Nee, dat is
Franco Ballerini is now coming in the picture as well.
Die gaat het moeilijk hebben, die gaat het moeilijk hebben.
And behind Ballerini here, Maurizio van Driest.
De twee Italianen. Vier man dus vooraan, Van Hooijdonk.
So, four riders settled down in the front. Museeuw, Sergeant, Ballerini, Da Conti. And then follows Van Driest and Willems. That makes six.
Zes man dus. Zes leiders en wat voor een groepje. Een echt elite groepje.
And still they try to reach. Max Chiandri followed by Bataro.
Chiandri is daar in elk geval bij.
And very soon the leading group is up to 8.
Dus we hebben nu 8 leiders.
So from 4 to 6 to 8. There'll be no one else coming this day.
Oh, kijk eens.
Ja.
The race behind had simply shut down. The big teams have got their men out in the lead.
Want tempo zit er nog helemaal links. En het komt in het achtervolgende groep. Nee, dat is over hier. Het is gebeurd.
You can do this on the Tour of Flanders because the roads are so narrow. Put your teammates on the front and there's nobody behind can race. The lead group were now settling down to plan their next move. Eddy van Hooijdonk was the leader here. The Molenberg, 300 meters of cobbles. These are real Tour of Flanders pictures. Big crowds, cheering people, cobblestones, hills, riders straining, and in the air, clouds threatening rain.
Volle mensen op de kant van de weg, die staan aan te moedigen waar uw haar van recht komt. Ja, de Ronde van Vlaanderen blijft een mooie.
It's at times like this when the Belgians believe the Tour of Flanders must be the prettiest race in the world.
Automatische schifting die er altijd komt, de goede renners vooraan. Dit samen met Parijs-Roubaix, dat zijn de twee.
The race has shuffled, reshuffled all day. And now it is a real monument to cycling. These 8 men will decide this year's Tour of Flanders.
Hier zijn we op dat steile stuk, net als steile stuk, dat moeilijker stuk.
Moeilijker stuk in elk geval, ja.
The race has now entered its next difficult phase.
Die was daar toen ook bij en kon niet mee.
En dat gaat hij terug proberen van Hooijdonk. Nee, toch niet. Er was iemand die wilde proberen.
Vooraan is het Museeuw.
Museeuw de Maret.
And it looks as though Edwin van Hooijdonk is one of the first riders to weaken. As Johan Museeuw attacks along with Frans Maassen. The others hesitate.
Van der Eest moet het nu gaan doen. Ja, dat is.
Ja, Maassen is nog niet op dat wiel van.
Well, Maassen is really having to fight to get onto Museeuw's wheel. Both riders are great single day classic winners.
Dat valt hier inderdaad stil. Er wordt
and there are all the others, but still there's no sign of a reaction. Are they beaten? And there's a gap now. Maassen is losing the wheel of Museeuw. There's now 75 meters between them. Maassen struggles back.
Dus de twee leiders, Museeuw en Maassen, hebben onze chrono even ingedrukt.
So the two leaders are back together. Johan Museeuw is the current champion of Belgium. Frans Maassen has been a champion of Holland.
Dat is al 13-14 seconden.
And the gap now is 15 seconds.
Maassen gaat meewerken.
Frans Maassen has recovered a little bit. He's now sharing the pace with Museeuw. The gap goes up to 20 seconds.
Ze zijn teruggekomen.
Ja, het was duidelijk.
Not far now to the Bosberg.
500 meter voor het begin van de Bosberg.
In recent years the Bosberg has become the last springboard to victory. Now, can Johan Museeuw rid himself of Frans Maassen?
Maassen rijdt goed hoor, Maassen rijdt goed.
They climb shoulder to shoulder.
Let op, dit is met een telelens, dus ik denk niet dat de.
And over the top of the Bosberg, you can see the gap. It's enough.
Just. Ze zien zich in elk geval rijden.
Officially, the gap is now 40 seconds for Museeuw and Maassen, with fewer than 3 kilometers left.
40 seconden voor Museeuw en Maassen.
Wat gaat er nu gebeuren?
The long straight road. Not the road leaders want to be on now because they're in constant sight of the chase group.
Daar vrees ik voor.
Museeuw.
Maassen die trekt zich op gang nu.
And when it came down to it at the finish, Frans Maassen was clearly no match for the fast-finishing Belgian Johan Museeuw. The champion of his country is now also the champion of the day. He wins the Tour of Flanders ahead of Frans Maassen.
Ja, ziet ook hoe is. 350 meter slecht.
De Koppenberg is 350 meters long. It's a narrow trail of bad cobblestones. Part of it are 52%, 1 in 2, 45 degrees. De Koppenberg is the highlight of any Flanders race. The trouble is, it's very narrow, and there's no room for standing on the roadside, so even spectating can be risky. The police are always there early. They spend hours keeping the day trippers off the road. There are grandstands even built for them, made up of straw bales. And then what they've been waiting for arrives. That's Didi Turo going up in the lead. Other great names. The man in trouble, Eddy Merckx. Joop Zoetemelk just manages to ride. Merckx wishes he could. There has to be easier ways to earn a living for Kees Priem. Gears and Turau is in trouble, and that means trouble for everyone.
Zo was de massa op de Koppenberg jaar na jaar verzekerd.
Which is why the Koppenberg has come to be the guaranteed spectacle of the Tour of Flanders. And then something happened which even the Tour of Flanders had never seen before. This incident with the Dane Jesper Skibby had consequences for the organizers. The Koppenberg was taken out of the race.
Dit incident met de Deen Jesper Skibby als slachtoffer had ook
Skibby had been in the lead for many, many kilometers, and the chief commissaire was so anxious to go by, they simply pushed him out the way. The result, Tour of Flanders shuns the Koppenberg. With an end then to the annual spectacle of the storming of the legendary Koppenberg, the road is empty of both riders and spectators. But even so, the Tour de Flanders remains what it's always been. As I said at the start, the Tour de Flanders is a fight against appalling cobblestones. A battle with gales and driving rain, and the agony of those infamous hills. It's spectacular, dramatic. It has happiness and disappointment. And it's every setback you can imagine. It's also half of Flanders out on the streets. But far more than all of that, the Tour of Flanders is an encyclopedia of bike racing's most famous names. It must never be allowed to die.